My name is Esteban from Redline Auto Parts, here to go over what to look for when buying a 1999 to 2005 NB Miata, such as this one right here. For more detailed information on the car, special editions, technical information, options, all that stuff, we've actually compiled that into written format. It will be linked in the description below. But for now, let's take a look at what to look for when buying one of these cars. So let's get straight into it. Let's check out the body on this car first. We're looking for anything that might be a deal breaker. I'm looking at the body lines to make sure everything lines up, sure the car doesn't have any accident damage that was not fixed properly or disclosed by the seller. And we're also going to be looking for rust. Rust on these cars is more commonly found here underneath the quarter panel right behind the door and also underneath the fender. When we get the car up in the air, we'll look at that a little bit more into detail. At this step, I just want to eliminate any cars from my search that are just not worth it. These cars are plentiful, so there's no reason to settle for one that at least isn't in good shape body-wise, let's say. So while I'm here, I'm also looking at the paint condition. This car appears to have original paint. It does have the little scrapes up front over there, and it has a little damage right here on the quarter panel. If we're looking at this car as far as something fun to drive around that we're not 100% committed to, looking like a show car, let's say, then this car is definitely in good condition for its age and something worth continuing with. If the car did need a full paint job, let's say, that'd be something definitely to factor into the price, because even though the cars are small and older, it does get very expensive to get a good quality paint job on these. Now looking underneath the hood, the area we're going to be concentrating on is right up here in the front core support. This is the area that would most likely get damaged in an accident and replaced. If it was bent back into shape, you would definitely be able to notice. This one appears to be 100% original. Or if it was replaced in the past, it was replaced all the way back here with the proper spot welds and it was replaced properly. This is an area, if you see this crinkled right here, more than likely the front of the car had an accident on it. And we also want to make sure that the hood is aluminum. On NA and NB Miatas, the factory hood is aluminum. In some cars, you'll see that they have a steel hood. That means that car was in an accident more than likely. The hood was replaced with an inferior steel part. People use those because they're cheaper than the aluminum ones. So we want to look at things like that. Now, the last area we want to look at on the exterior of this car is the convertible soft top. If the car that you're looking at does need a soft top, I wouldn't call it a deal breaker. Like on some cars, like a BMW Z4, let's say a Mercedes, something like that would have a bunch of hydraulics and electronics, and it is very complicated to replace these tops. On these cars, you can get away with, if you want to go on the low end and do it yourself, an eBay top for about $180 shipped, or you get a good used one on the frame still, which is about the easiest to install one of these. That's about $200 to $300. Or if you wanted to have a professional do it and you want to have a factory style top with a glass window, that could run you anywhere from $500 to $800 or so, but definitely not a deal breaker. A good negotiating point though. Also, one thing to look at on these tops, it has two latches that connect it to the windshield header over here. These latches are supposed to be released with this button. If they just release like this, that means the latch has been worn. There is an online guide on how to take these apart and repair them, or you'd have to replace them in order to get the top to stay in place. I don't see how this particular top with two bad latches would stay up at highway speeds, but apparently they were driving it around like that. Now, the last thing to look at on these convertible tops is something that isn't very obvious, is the water drainage. These cars have what they call a rain rail. It's a piece of plastic. It's like a U-shaped, V-shaped piece of plastic that goes right here. So water gets onto the top, water goes into that channel, and it gets channeled right over here to these drains. These drains on this car appear to be very clogged. So what happens is, if the rain rail is working properly, water is channeling in there And instead of draining down there, it is pooling up inside the car, which will get water inside, underneath the carpet, underneath the seats, everywhere in there. And if the rain rail isn't doing its job and it's cracked or broken, which is the case on these, they get very brittle, then it'll leak into this area right here. If you take off this carpet piece, you'll see a galvanized piece of metal. And if that is rusted, then that's an indication that this car leaked or leaks currently from the rain rail. And also, it'll also leak into the trunk area, so that's another area that we want to look at for water pooling. If you get to it in time, it's just surface rust, something you can handle. If it looks like it's been like that for years, then it might be something a little bit more to be concerned about. Now, moving on to the interior of the car, this is personally one of the areas that I like to see very well kept when I'm looking to buy a Miata for myself, because that gives a good indication as to how well they kept the rest of the car, how much they cared about it. Things like the dash are some things that hold up very well over time on this car, so it's very unusual to see some cracks up there, heat cracking. It's very unusual to see the cluster hood have any damage. The steering wheels hold up pretty good over time. A lot of time you'll see them worn right here. The door panels usually hold up pretty good. The seats is what gets most of the wear and tear on these cars. This particular car is a 2002, so the 2001 to 2003 seats have this kind of mesh right here. This is very common. This doesn't mean that the car was not taken care of, it just means that that's what happens with it over time. And this is also a very common spot, the vinyl right here on the sides. On all the 99 on up seats, they like to rip right there. Now, looking at the other side of the interior right here, we see that this door panel does have some wear right there. It looks like some moisture got in there onto the backing and made that bubble. That door panel will probably need replacement soon. Everything on this side looks good. The seat is actually in very good condition. Some scratches here and there, but overall nothing too bad. If you do see a lot of wear on the interior, let's say both door panels are bad, both seats are bad, the carpet's worn on the driver's side, the center console's broken, that's where things really start to add up though, because the parts on these cars are actually a little bit more expensive than you would think for a 2002 or a 99 to 05 basically. Now to the fun part, let's see if everything works. There's not a whole lot of electronics, not a whole lot of complicated items on this car, but there are some things to look at that definitely could end up costing you money if you don't notice them ahead of time. First thing we want to look at is the operation of the power windows. If it's slow like this, it's pretty normal, but it does look like it works correctly at least. These window regulators, especially the driver's side one, go bad very often. In this case, it looks like we have two good working ones. Now, looking at the radios, these aren't known to be the most reliable radios in the world. Usually they have problems with the display, with the volume knobs, and with the CD player. In this case, those things actually look good, but when we do turn the radio itself on, we're looking at the power antenna, which needs replacement. It's supposed to go up to about here. There's about six sections, and this one definitely does not work correctly. Of course, you also have the climate controls to look at. These are things that don't usually go bad. Of course, you want to look at the rest of the AC system, but nothing too bad right there. And of course, the instrument cluster here. We're going to give this car a start. If possible, try to make sure that the person selling the car hasn't driven the car, so you can get a cold start, so you can get a good feel for how it starts when it's nice and cold, rather than something that's already been turned on and left running for a while. In this case, this car was not hard to start and it does idle correctly. It's got 84,000 miles on it, so it does seem like it works properly. There's no check engine lights to look at. And we also want to make sure that the temperature doesn't ever go above about the 11 o'clock, 11:30 mark. Anything past that is considered getting hot, hotter than usual on these cars. Now, underneath the hood, everything sounds nice and healthy. The camera picks up a little bit too much injector noise, but if you were right here with me, you'd notice that everything sounds like it should. When we rev it up, there's no exhaust leaks. What we're looking at here is the front crank pulley at about idle speed, about 900 RPM. You want to make sure that it does not have any excess wobble.
usually when you do see some wobble on the crank pulley, you'll see some accompanying oil leaks. As the front of the crank wobbles, it'll wear on the oil seal and create a massive leak at the front. This one appears to be fine. I know you've probably heard about issues with the cranks on the earlier Miatas, the short nose cranks, but in reality, any of the 90 to 05 Miatas can be susceptible to it. When somebody does a timing belt job on these, if they do not torque that bolt down there properly, it will begin to wear. It'll wear the keyway on the crank, requiring major repair. Now, this car does not look like it's very clean under here. This car, in all fairness, came from a salvage auction, so maybe it was due to that or due to general lack of maintenance. But everything does look factory. The intake tube is there, there's no hose clamps missing, the wiring is factory, doesn't appear to be messed with, which is definitely what I prefer to see on these cars. Now, in order to get a better look at the specific mechanicals on this car, we're using this drivetrain that's being dropped out of a 99 Miata. Looks a little bit different because we've modified it a bit to fit into a 95, but it'll work for these purposes. We want to look at the front of the engine, if there's any missing covers right here. If all these seals are oil soaked, that means the car's been leaking for a while. The cam seal right behind here and here like to leak. Those are very common. Even if it's a low mileage car, these two are probably leaking if they haven't been replaced before. Same thing goes for the crank seal. They like to leak even if the pulley isn't wobbling. Now, the timing belt interval on these cars is about 70,000 miles. I may be wrong, but around there is when they need to get done. The good thing is, if it doesn't seem like it was done for a long time, or if it's questionable when the last time it was done, is these are non-interference motors, so even if the timing belt snaps, you won't have any internal engine damage, the valves won't hit the pistons or anything. So that's at least one good thing. But also one of the reasons why some people put off timing belt jobs on these cars, because they know it won't cause any permanent damage. They just put it off and put it off. So it may be something you need to factor into your budget if it needs to be done or not. Now, looking at the back of the engine, there's a couple areas where these like to leak. On the earlier cars, they have a cam sensor like this. On the NBs, they typically have a little cap that goes right here. It's about $11 or $12 brand new from Mazda, but if that little cap is leaking, it'll leak all over the back right here and on top of the heater hose. If this heater hose gets leaked on for a while, it will deteriorate and it will burst at some point, leaving you probably stranded at that point. Now, also, we can't see it from here, but if we're looking underneath the car, if you see some leaking on between the engine and transmission, that's very common. It's commonly referred to as the rear main seal, but usually where it actually leaks from is the little half moon seal in between the oil pan and the block. Now, moving on back here, next thing you'll see, of course, you'd have to look at it from inside the car, would be the shifter. These shifters, the bushings like to go bad on them, these boots like to go bad, so you'll probably see a leak from underneath, but it's not the end of the world. These parts are very easy to replace and very common, so about $75 shifter rebuild kit, you'd be all set. Now, the top view of the differential, the differentials on these cars, on the MBs, the 99 on up, are very stout. You rarely get issues with them. We'll be looking at the condition of the boots for the axles. Unless the car is lowered, really lowered, and really high miles, we usually don't see any problems with these axles. They're very durable. We do sometimes see some leaks right around here. These axle seals aren't very difficult to replace, so that's not a big issue. Where we don't want to see any leaks at all is at the front right here, the pinion seal. If the pinion seal is leaking, that would require a rebuild of the differential at that point. So we definitely want to avoid that. Looking at the drive shaft, these cars have U-joints that are not replaceable. So when they go bad, you need to replace the entire drive shaft. Usually good used units are available out there, or even brand new ones are just expensive if you want to go the brand new route, are available. But definitely not a deal breaker if you need a drive shaft on these. It's not that difficult to replace, just something to budget. Of course, we also want to look at the things that go bad on every car and every used car. Worn bushings, looking at the brakes. These cars, since they're lightweight, they're not usually too abusive on the brakes. The calipers sometimes leak. They're fairly inexpensive to rebuild or replace, so not a deal breaker as well. The bushings, they usually last a very long time. You'll notice some deterioration in performance, but it's not something that absolutely needs replacement, even if the car has higher miles, unless you want to get back that new car feeling. At the front, the typical areas where you see concerns up here is the ball joint bushing for the front upper control arm, the bottom ball joint right there, as well as the sway bar end links and the tie rod ends. In this case, everything appears to be in good condition. These parts are fairly inexpensive if they need to be replaced. Nothing to cause great concern unless you see a bent control arm or something that looks like accident damage under here. Now we're looking for damage underneath the car. One of the areas we want to start looking at is the frame rail. If the car has major rust issues, you'll see some rust right there. This is where the sway bar mount mounts to, right in front of the shock in the front of the car. No issues there. Looking underneath the fenders, you'll see some leaves collecting under there. Those leaves will collect moisture and make that fender rust from the inside out, so just make sure of that. If there's no rust in there currently, I definitely recommend loosening the bottom of the fender and getting those leaves out of there. Now the main area we want to look at for rust is right back here. It doesn't look like this car has suffered anything. You'll usually see it in the suspension as well. If the body is rusting, the suspension will be rusting as well. One of the things we want to look at back here is that a lot of these cars come with factory side skirts. They basically come up to right about here. Some people, if they do have a big rust spot right here, they like to cover it up with the side skirts. So just be very careful of that, that there's no hidden damage somebody can easily get away with. And there you have it. Hopefully we've been able to show you the areas of concern and the areas that aren't too big of a concern on these cars, what to look out for, what are deal breakers to make sure that you make a good buying decision when buying your Miata. That sometimes that $2,000 Miata that seems like a good deal but needs a lot of work ends up being more expensive in the long run than that $3,500 or $4,000 one that was well sorted. You just want to make sure that you don't end up with a project on your hands down the road. If you found this video helpful, please make sure to give it a like. And if you need any parts for your NB Miata or for any other generation Miata, we have a whole selection of used parts available online at redlineautoparts.com. Thank you for watching.